Okay, Professor Gerth, his first book was China Made, Consumer Culture and the Creation of the Nation. It examines the connections between nationalism and consumerism in China in the first half of the 20th century. In addition, he has published and presented papers on comparative aspects of modern Chinese and world history, including consumption and consumerism in East Asia, the origins and implications of Chinese brand nationalism, and the ecological implications of Chinese consumerism. He's been awarded numerous grants to support his research, including from the British Academy, the Fulbright Foundation, the Jiang Qingguo Foundation, the American Council of Learned Societies, the Blakemore Foundation, and the Japanese Ministry of Education Scholarship for 2 years of study at Tokyo University. He's currently completing a book that uses archival materials, periodicals, memoirs, and interviews conducted in China to investigate the survival of market practices in the nation's urban centers following the establishment of communist rule in 1949. In addition, he's the Chinese co-team leader of the Oslo-based Series 21 project, currently investigating innovative adaptations in the automotive and power industries to climate and environmental change on three continents. Now we're lucky to have Professor Gerth just down the 15 at UCSD. Prior to that, he completed his PhD at Harvard in 2000, taught at the University of South Carolina until in 2007 when he moved to Oxford. And it's just this year that he's come to us here in Southern California. With that, I'll finally end with one note. I don't know if any of you saw online any of Professor Gerth's interviews, but there was one on the Charlie Rose show. And if you watched the entire show, you saw that Professor Gerth shared the show with Robert De Niro. So when Charlie Rose wants to know about acting, he calls Robert De Niro. And when he wants to know about China, he calls Karl Gerth. Please welcome Karl Gerth.
That's Bobby D to his friends. I actually did ask if I could sit in the same seat that he sat in. I'm sure some of that talent rubbed off, or maybe something else rubbed off. I think it had been a long night for Bobby D. I'd like to start by thanking Jeremy for doing all the organizational work behind this. Academics don't get paid to do this kind of stuff. They do it because they want to create activity at their campus and bring together communities. So I really admire you doing all that thankless work, as well as the organizations you mentioned before. And of course, thank all of you for coming here. As Jeremy said, I taught in Oxford for 6 years before coming to California. And there would have been nobody at a talk, at an academic talk in an afternoon, if the sun had been shining like this. So thanks to all of you who consider it a sacrifice to be indoors, as I do on a day like today. I want to begin by having you take a look at this photograph up here. 27 years ago, when I was roughly your age, I was a junior in college, I dropped out of college to travel around China for a year. 27 years later, 25 years later, I ended up writing a book about what China was like back then and what China has become. So you could think the question for such a book isn't just kind of description. Oh, once upon a time, we had to walk both ways uphill in the snow to get to school. Nowadays, we have mommy and daddy, you know, call the chauffeur and take us in the Mercedes to school. It isn't that type of book. The trick isn't coming up with descriptions of what I saw 27 years ago and what I see now. I don't think that would be that interesting for anybody, including for me. The trick, as I see it, is to figure out what does all of that mean? How did that happen, and what does all that mean? How can we keep all of that change, that transformation that we've seen in China, perhaps the most dramatic transformation anywhere in world history in the last 30 years? How can we make sense of it? I want to try to give you a way of making sense of that, and I want to suggest that that motive force for what's changing China revolves around what's going on in this young lady's head here. This photograph, taken by my friend sitting over there, was taken in the Barbie store in Shanghai when it first opened, subsequently went bankrupt. But at that Barbie store, which was something like five stories high, you could have all of your Barbie needs met. You could not only buy Barbie dolls of every variation, but you could also have a fashion consult so that you too could look more like Barbie. This seems like a sort of flippant topic. But again, what I want to suggest to you is that this 30 years of dramatic change, perhaps the largest transformation in human history of any one location revolves around what's going in this person's head. How do we turn this country of now 1.3 billion people into a country similar to ours or similar to Western Europe, where people are driven by the desire to buy more and more things such as Barbie and lead lifestyles similar to ours? And what are the trade-offs of trying to get China to be a more consumer-driven economy and society? That's the question that I want to ask today. I think because this topic is so big, it helps us focus the mind. This is, you're not supposed to read any of these graphs. These graphs are supposed to represent the flood of information that we get from China in any given newspaper. All sorts of stuff about GDP growth or protests or unemployment or bad toys or undervalued currency or any of the stories that we see coming out of China. Overwhelming amount of information. I want to suggest to you in my talk today that the best way of interpreting this avalanche or this flood of information is to look at this central tension revolving around what was going on in that woman's head. What sort of life should I be leading, and what are the implications of that life for the rest of the world? I think that that story could be best be told by a story of my own, beginning with my childhood getting bad haircuts from my mom. True story, my mom used to drop a bowl on my head and snip, 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 snip around. As you can see, the quality of my haircuts hasn't gotten much better in the intervening 46 years since then. Now, what does this story have to do with anything about China, less understanding what I'm going to try to convince you is the motive or driving force behind what is changing China and therefore what is changing the globe? Well, in the amount of time it took me to grow a lot more hair and then lose some of that hair, China itself has gone from the land of the bad haircut, where once upon a time when I would go to China, and probably in places that Jeremy goes, you can still get very bad haircuts for 5 cents or so, has gone from the land of very bad haircut to the land of very good haircuts. In fact, now when I go to China, I usually save up my need for a haircut until I get there because the cost is so low and the quality of the scrubbing of the hair and the specialized people that they have rubbing various parts of, well, various legitimate parts of my body, at least. I can't speak for Jeremy where he spends his time, but in mine, they're just rubbing the parts they're meant to be rubbing publicly. How did that transformation from the land of, I will, dare I say, bad haircuts to the land of a place where I wait to get my haircut? A lot of that can be seen in the growth of these industries in the service sector in China. Once upon a time when I first went to China 27 years ago, it was very hard to get a haircut at all. Haircut places were only, barbershops were only open and open during banker's hours. Having lived in England, I can tell you the banker's hours actually mean banker's hours, meaning they open late and close early. And they were usually only located in the center of town. Flash forward 20, 30 years, we go from a place where which it's hard to get a haircut to a place in which China, now its beauty industry is its fifth largest. Fifth most important industry driving its economy is now the beauty industry. This for me then, that picture of me with the bowl on my head to flash forwarding where 10 barbershops per square block in China's major cities encapsulates some of that transformation of China being a land that's horrible from the point of view of that woman, land of consumer, to China that's becoming, in some ways, a consumer paradise and in some ways a consumer nightmare. I want to suggest then that tension between China being a land of great haircuts to China being a land that's creating problems because of that consumer dimension is the most important story. And that's much more important than the sort of standard stories that you'll read about in any given news cycle. It's my hunch that every time a new reporter is dispatched to China from Washington or wherever he or she was located beforehand, we'll go through a list of standard stories about China. When I was young in the 1980s, we used to see the same thing about when Japan was all the rage. They'd go through the same sort of standard stories about Japanese vending machines that sell things that really ought not be sold in vending machines. So these are the sort of stories that I think are common here. And we can talk about how important each one of these stories are. Chinese military budgets. Back a year and a half ago, when it looked like China might be developing stealth bombers, we heard all sorts of things about we should be really worried about the increase of money that the Chinese are spending on their military. Again, not saying these aren't important or interesting stories. I'm saying that what I want to suggest to you is the story behind all these stories, the central tension or the driver behind all of this, the key for helping you understand all of these news stories of what or what's really going on. So these are the sort of stories that we hear during the news cycle, stuff about China using energy. One or another, Ai Weiwei comes along seemingly every two or three years. For those people who don't know, Ai Weiwei is the sort of political dissident of de jure, the kind of artist who's rebelling against the state and having all sorts of problems for it. Not saying this isn't a serious problem or whatever, I'm just saying what else may be framing all of these things. Other stories we hear about inflation or currency reevaluations or China's manipulation supposedly of its currency in order to keep the prices of its exports low. They don't want their currency to appreciate too much because then they'll become less competitive. Kremlinology, this is what we used to call experts who had studied the Soviet Union, now Russia. Who's behind Putin? How did Putin get his power? Who might be the next Putin? These are all the sort of questions you wonder about when you don't study a transparent political structure. You kind of have to kind of guess by reading this or that into very small signs. Who's standing where on the podium when they're reviewing some military parade? This was called Kremlinology, and we see the same sort of stuff existing about China today. Who's up, who's down? And then the last and perennial topic is war with Taiwan. That seems to have dropped by the wayside quite a bit. 10, 15, 20 years ago, you used to see quite a bit of that tension, cross-strait tension. I'll explain a little bit why in a minute. I want to suggest that rather than these stories over here, these kind of stuff that we get inundated with stories about in Western media, that the real transformation is this China's attempt to move from being an export-led economy to one being driven by its own consumers. And that this transformation is leading to the transformation not only of the lives of hundreds of millions of Chinese, but I want to suggest transforming the entire world in the process. And so in other words, even if you don't care about the lives of hundreds of millions of Chinese and how this new economic logic is shaping their lives, it's going to have huge impacts and is already having huge impacts on here. So the contradiction, to give away the punchline, the contradiction that I want to talk about is China in the last 30 years, since I started going there, has both of these things simultaneously. It's both what you may see here as consumer paradise with endless amounts of choice taking to its sort of logical extreme conclusion that there's so many drinks that when you go into one of these corner stores, you sort of jaw drops and like, what could I possibly, spend 10 minutes deciding which bottled water to buy rather than having to take a thermos to some boiled water location as we used to have to do. So on the one hand, consumer paradise, good, China is on track to lead lives just like ours to an enviable degree. On the other hand, what are the sort of consequences not only for China but of the rest of the world? Maybe there are some negatives and not just positives associated with China moving from having a pretty low standard of living to China having this sort of consumer paradise-like existence. One thing is for sure, you don't have to read this. A secret of teaching industry I learned relatively recently is that if you put your notes on PowerPoint, you can speak without having to read notes all the time. So if I just put it up there. So that's more for my sake than your sake. What all this stuff essentially says up here is that there's a global consensus among political and business elites, whether they're in China or whether they're in America or whether in Western Europe. And that consensus, that agreement of political and economic elites is that China needs to cut it out. It needs to become a more consumer-driven economy. Instead of investing in endless numbers of roads and airports, instead of relying on us to drive its economy by consuming more and more Chinese products, China needs to figure out ways to get its own consumers to do its part in driving global economic development by buying more stuff. Go think back to that Barbie picture. Instead of her pausing, she should be in there sweeping them up, doing her share to generate global economic growth by buying and consuming and leading the sort of lifestyles that we live. So these quotes are from various people across the political spectrum. Doesn't matter whether it's Obama or Bush or whatever, this global consensus says that China must move in this direction of creating a consumer-driven economy. And I want to today talk about why that's happening and also why that might be problematic. So the kind of overarching question then is, will Chinese consumers spend enough to rescue the world economy? Will they replace the overspent Americans and Western Europeans, buy more cars, buy more Barbie dolls, create the sort of economic growth that keeps our retirement funds managers happy? What are the implications then? What's the flip side of that? What happens if Chinese drive as many cars as we drive? Is they eat as much beef per capita per person as we eat? If they take as many plane rides and so on? What are the trade-offs then, positive and negative, of China becoming a society much more similar to ours? Well, fortunately, we have somebody who's managed to figure out how to put all these pieces together in the form of that fine book that's for sale over there, or frankly for sale for much less money on Amazon. I want to briefly talk about what the contents of that and save you the trouble of reading it to suggest again, how do I take that picture of, oh my God, what happened to that place that I visited 30 years ago to today? How did that transformation take place? And I want to suggest that rather than just giving you sort of bland description, oh, back when I was a kid, we had to do this, or there were, you know, we could only travel in China by hard seat across, you know, endless train lines to nowhere, to what it's like today. Instead of just going on in that description, I want to give you this kind of constant sense of that trade-off between, congratulations, China, you've transformed your country into something incredibly impressive for hundreds of millions of people who have been lifted out of poverty and now have the same opportunities to drive cars or eat McDonald's or lead the sort of things that we consider part of the good life, on the one hand, with on the other hand, what are the trade-offs both for Chinese people as well as the rest of the globe? I do that all of those things in the first chapter, which you can read online. Cars. How did China go from being a land where there was no such thing as private vehicles to, by 2009, it's the world's largest not only consumer or buyer of automobiles to the world's largest producer or maker or manufacturer of automobiles? How did that happen almost in the blink of an eye? Something like 15 years, 20 years, it goes from no private cars to the world's largest car market. And what does that say about economic development in China then and now going forward? I'm going to talk about this one at length. These others I'll just summarize briefly as a way of piquing your consumer interest and possibly exercising it at the table over there. This new rich chapter is about, well, who are these new rich people in China? Where do they get their money and what are the problems with it? One of the things that's sort of interesting as an American when you travel to other places and come back here is the seeming endless capacity we have to tolerate inequality. The assumption that the reason why I'm rich and you all are poor is because I worked harder than you did. Nothing to do with white male who grew up in a rich suburb of Chicago. Nothing to do with, everything to do with, I'm a harder worker than you are. In China, I don't think that's the case. In China, I think there's a love-hate relationship with wealthy people. Why would they love wealthy people? Well, they want to have their lifestyles too. Wealthy people the world over sort of are the people that you want to emulate. You want to go on the same type of vacation, drive the same kind of car, wear the same type of watch. That's the love bit. The hate bit, on the other hand, the part that's creating tension in China is, how do they get that money? There's a feeling in China that most, if not all, wealthy people in China got wealthy because they were politically connected. And it's those political connections, and now, frankly, in California, it's the laundering of money, perhaps gotten illy, is that an adverb, illy, through not the most proper of means, that is driving up housing prices in California. I heard one statistic, don't quote me on this one, that one-third, maybe it's even higher, of houses sold in California above $2 million are going to Chinese people. Where did they get that money? And why are they in such a hurry to get it overseas? I don't know. In any case, I'm not saying that everyone in China who's rich got it because they were politically connected or through corruption or something like that. I'm saying that in China, one of the social tensions, this positive side, lots of people are getting wealthy. Negative side, there's a huge level of inequality, and that's creating social tension. That's what I'm going to do the whole day here, not spoon feed you my conclusion about what's going wrong with the world or China, but rather look at this tension between how wonderful and admirable it is that China has transformed itself on one level to what are the kind of implications for that may lead to problems for China and therefore the rest of us down the road. The main Taiwan chapter I'll just mention briefly, one of these questions about is how did China manage to transform itself so quickly when, say, Africa hasn't managed to make similar kinds of transformation? Overseas Chinese is the short answer to that. Hong Kong, Southeast Asia, other Chinese investing billions of dollars, lending the know-how in order to transform their society very quickly. I also believe in my Taiwan, my younger Taiwanese friends who want to see Taiwan as an independent polity don't like when I conclude by saying that I think a lot of, in my brief time of following this issue, the party that had previously been all about independence is now all about investing and making money in the mainland, and how are you going to have much of an independence movement if the DPP is getting rich investing in China? But that's a separate and perhaps more controversial sort of subject. These next chapters, I'm not going to go through all of them one by one. I'll just mention them briefly before talking at CARS at length. It's all about, well, what happens, what is the transformation of Chinese society when you go from having a land of mom and pop shops to a land of McDonald's? How do you standardize people's consciousness, whether they're in Heilongjiang in the far northeast of China, or they're in Yunnan province in the southwest? How do you standardize the experience of being a Chinese consumer through the standardization of the shopping experience? So people, whether they're in Heilongjiang having McDonald's or they're in Yunnan having McDonald's, with the token exceptions of maybe they have some kind of Mongolian beef or whatever, I don't eat any of that stuff, so I'm not the best expert on this, would be different, slightly different menu options, essentially the same type of consumer experience, whether you're up there or you're in the south. Branding consumer consciousness is an outgrowth of my earlier work. I'm very interested in Chinese government's anxiety about something called moving up the value chain. Moving up the value chain means instead of just doing the low-end grunt work, say stuffing toys for Disney is my favorite example, that doesn't require a lot of education to know how to stuff a toy with cotton. And it doesn't add a lot of value. So whoever is doing the stuffing or whatever company is organizing the labor to do the stuffing is very low on the value chain. Whoever owns the word Disney, on the other hand, is making a lot more money. So I'm very interested in how China is anxiously trying to push up the value chain into the ownership of internationally recognized brands as a way of making sure that its economy continues to grow. Because otherwise, it's stuck at the bottom end where it's less and less competitive. Why is it less and less competitive? Because the cost of labor there, as it becomes more expensive, people who make shoes, bicycles, stuff Disney toys, they move that stuff to places where the labor costs are lower. So in this chapter, I look at how China is trying to ensure that it moves its way up the value chain by creating even at the expense of buying expensive international brands, Volvo springs to mind, international brands as a way of making sure that in the future, brands, if we don't even know them to be Chinese, they may be owned by Chinese. These last three that I'll just summarize together is the sort of scary downside of all of this. Living in the world of fakes. If someone like me who studies the world through the lens of consumer experience is looking at what's going on in China, one of the things that we see there is this very unpleasant shopping experience where you never know in the store if what says it's a Gucci handbag is a Gucci handbag or it's a knockoff. Or if you go to a pharmaceutical company, maybe that's real, maybe it's not. What happens if moving up that value chain, you're relying on people paying a premium for something that says Gucci because they assume the quality, or something that says Bayer rather than generic aspirin. You're willing to pay a premium on that. If you live in a land where there are so many counterfeits, then it's very hard to create that type of capitalism or that type of market that can be based around brands. I also think, this is my interpretation, that this is not only destabilizing capitalism as we know it in China, but it's destabilizing it in other places as well, because the stuff, these counterfeits, once they get in the supply chain, they get in the supply chain that goes all over the world. So pretty soon, products that you would assume would be very reliable, or say stores like maybe Toys R Us, where you would assume that they have some quality control, will get some sort of toxic toy or something because they would have been corrupted through the supply chain, would undermine the value of a place called Toys R Us, because instead of seeing it as a land to buy inexpensive but reliable toys, you see it as a, I don't know, conduit for toxic toys. Extreme markets is a look at Chinese buying and selling of things that had been impossible or at least hard to buy and sell in the Mao period. So what happens with deregulation? When the government withdraws from regulating the marketplace, you see the emergence of things that you can buy and sell, like babies or body parts, or body parts, meaning you go to China to get a cornea replaced, as one of my informants did. How is that enabled by all this reform? Again, the overall picture here is three cheers for China for having transformed its society into something where middle class people can buy and enjoy lifestyles that had been undreamt of when I started going there, to yes, three cheers on the one hand, but also what are the sort of uncertainties. Environmental stuff I'll get back to with cars in just a minute. That perhaps is the most alarming. So back to that original question of why China and how China managed to create a car culture and car economy in 20 years. I say culture and economy, I separate those two things. Economy meaning there's a lot of people in China whose livelihoods depend on now the manufacturer, sale, and use of cars. That's the economy bit. The society bit is, where does that push come from? Or even people who live next door to where they work, why are they buying cars? Why is the sort of social ethos or environment that such that you feel like you really need a car, whether you really need a car or not? So that question is, why did China go that route? This isn't just smarty pants historians, hindsight 2020. Oh, look at me, Mr. Know-it-all. Those stupid Chinese, they should have known better, blah, blah, blah. This is Chinese who up until the 1990s recognized and even applauded themselves for not having gone the car route. They knew, as the Chinese Academy of Sciences issued a report in the early 90s, reminding Chinese leaders that this would be the outcome. They would have acid rain falling on a third of their country. They would lose their oil energy independence. They'd have to go to places that we have to go to, some unsavory places on the planet, in order to get the resources to run those cars. Why would they do that anyway? I believe that that's one of the most important historical questions of the late 20th century. And I would give you a little bit of a hint at my answer at that. But first, let's address the obvious. I think when people hear this, they must, I hate cars. I live in California. I'm one of those, you know, hitchhike to work guys or something, ride my bicycle or whatever it is, horseback, something like that. No, I recognize the pleasures of having one's own car. There is the status of it. I have a nice car, safety. Well, I don't know about that. Air conditioning is certainly nice in China, along with the air conditioning meaning taking out the pollution. I like to listen to my own music, fancy. I put my MP3 player in now, and I get just the music I want. So I can recognize why Chinese people would want that same type of stuff. But I use, beyond that, the story of this professor friend of mine at Huadong Shidai at East China Normal University in Shanghai, and his story of his efforts to resist buying a car, but ultimately him saying, I have to buy a car. Because of what I want to suggest to you, that it's more than individual desire. This is an important point to make. I want to make in America that we live in today, because I think there's an assumption oftentimes in certain political segments of America that a big government just gets out of the way, that nature, meaning markets, will take its course, and everybody will stream to run, or will run and get cars. I think that's the assumption that you might have about the China story as well. Why didn't Chinese people have private cars? Because big, bad, evil Chinese government used to forbid them from having cars. And once they got out of their way, nature took its course, and voila, China has the world's largest market for cars. Sure, there's an element for it, and I want to recognize that element and say, yes, 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 we all like having personal mobility in that way. But I also want to look at the role of the Chinese government of pushing people into needing cars. This wasn't just them getting out of the way saying, okay, folks, have at it. That was the Chinese government for a very specific strategic reason saying we need everyone to start buying cars. You can see, I hope, now how I'm connecting this back towards China creating a society and economy like ours that's driven by individuals like that woman in the first photo taken by my friend over there to buy Barbie dolls. You can see that story replicated in the case of cars. We don't just say, okay, buy Barbie dolls, don't buy, as a bourgeois whatever, don't buy Barbie dolls, buy cars, don't buy cars, it's up to you. We get them to buy cars. Here's my fancy management consultant friend made overly complex graph, which is again a more of a reminder for me of the different elements. You don't need to read all of that, but I'll just summarize what all of that is. Each one of those four quadrants is areas in which had nothing to do with your DNA kicking in and you're buying a car because you absolutely, positively, biologically are driven to buy a car, but the ways in which the Chinese state influences and forces people to buy cars. When I started going to China, most people lived and worked either in the same locations in major cities, or they worked nearby or could get there relatively easily by bicycle. Now China has something called central business districts, CBDs, a term I only learned when I started going to China. My Chinese friend assumed that I had heard of that, but I hadn't heard of it. I think someone told me Singaporeans at the first call. Anyway, central business districts. What does that mean? It means the land in the center of the city cost a lot more to live in than the land outside or on the periphery of the cities. So the people that could live in the cities, well, not everybody could afford to live there. So essentially, they're priced out of the market, or frankly, their houses are confiscated, demolished, and they're given nickels on the dollar for the value of their land. Major contentious issue in China is all of these illegal appropriations, state appropriations of land. Those same illegal appropriations is what's been funding Chinese local government for decades now. So it's an incredibly integrated part of the creating central business districts and creating something out of nothing, creating high-rises, and the money that goes to from that is an incredibly important part of Chinese growth story. But that's separate from what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about is a land in which you now need to start needing to have a car because you can't get to work by just walking next door, or you can't get to the sort of middle-class exciting things to do like the shopping mall or the road trip to the ski resort or whatever it is. All of those things require personal mobility, and all of that is a consequence of these decisions made by the state. But if we're giving the Chinese government a hard time for the decisions it's made, despite the warnings from its own Academy of Sciences, knowing what they were going to lose their oil independence, knowing that they were going to start creating all of this acid rain, I also hold some blame for global financial institutions like the WTO. It's my personal belief, this story is complex, so you can weigh your own bits of evidence on your own and come to your own conclusion. But my own personal take on this is China developed the car industry because it felt like it had a very small window of opportunity from the time in which it said, yes, we're going to join the WTO in 1993 to 2001 when it becomes a full member. In that time, it can dangle the China market as this wonderfully large car market and get foreign companies to create all these partnerships, transfer all this technology, invest billions on terms that were still favorable to China developing its own domestic car industry. So the Chinese government felt, if you go back to that moving up the value chain, unless they wanted to be stuck, and being stuck at the low end of just stuffing toys meant that all those hundreds of millions of newly beginning to feel affluent, beginning to feel like you have some money, middle-class Chinese, now feel like their government maybe is slightly problematic, to put it politely, maybe ought to be pushed aside or overthrown or something like that, isn't creating jobs for them. So they see then moving up the value chain, not just as an economic issue, as saving China and creating a new round of economic growth, but also as a political issue, that if they don't move up that value chain, they're going to have problems. So going back to the early 1990s then, when the decision was to push cars, then the state saw it as its best available option. I remember speaking to a high-placed banker in China about this. I'm like, how could you have been so crazy? You're basically committing your country to dependence on imported oil, on all of that pollution, And he described it as like triage. You have what he called a 20-year problem and an immediate problem. The immediate problem was we'd better create those middle-class jobs and get those people shifting out of working for Disney. Otherwise, there's going to be a lot bigger problems than that. I don't see an easy solution to all of this. The one easy solution that you might think is China moving in, is using the same state, kick them in the rear, kick them being the Chinese consumers in the rear, to transition them from internal combustion engine, namely gas cars, into electric cars. But anyone who's looked at all into how electricity is generated in China, namely mainly by burning incredibly polluting coal, realizes that that's maybe not the easiest solution for solving what I'll get to in a second, are the environmental problems. So the impacts on China are as you've seen. I remember when this first story, there's probably been endless stories since 2010 when I first downloaded this photo of this traffic jam that stretched 100 kilometers. What's that, 60 miles, something like that? My maths aren't so good this time of day. So a giant traffic jam. I remember thinking to myself, I've been on that road. I think it was that way all the time. So it didn't seem like anything special, like special traffic jam. Maybe the foreign reporter that day took that and recognized it to be that way. The point of it being that, again, this isn't historians, smarty-pants historians saying, oh, look at all these horrible consequences they have. What a surprise. All of these things were known, but the feeling was they had to push into them anyway. Now, of course, China is retroactively trying to solve or ease some of this. By building mass transportation. Why? Because no one will buy those cars that they need people to buy if they can't get out their driveway because the traffic looks like this. Yeah, so exactly as predicted, China loses its oil energy independence. It's also responsible for a huge percentage of the increase in global demand for oil. I also predict in this book lots of what I consider to be blindingly obvious things, like it's only a matter of time before one of those Gulf spills that the British were responsible for is done by a Chinese deep sea oil rig. It's only a matter of time. And what is that going to be like when instead of a aristocratic Oxbridge-like guy who just got back from yachting, sorry American, lower middle class fisherman, sorry for destroying your waterway. Imagine it's a Chinese person, maybe not with perfect fluent in English, explaining all of this stuff. You can imagine the sort of tensions that are going to come as a result of this. Well, some of these tensions already exist. There was an effort to paint the Beijing Olympics as the genocide Olympics because of Beijing's support for the Sudan, where it was getting some of its oil. As I said, there's a huge push now for China to move in the direction of green cars. And a lot of environmentalist types are all like, yay, China. But in my interpretation, this is a flag for you're allowed to disagree, environmental concerns of the horrendous kind I'll get to in a second in China are third on the list of importance. The first thing on the list of importance is geopolitics, where you get your oil from that China's worried about. They're the Saudi Arabia of coal. They've got plenty of coal, but they don't have any oil anymore, or they have to import, as we see, 50%+ of their oil. Second importance, even in higher than the pollution problems we'll get to, is as I said, moving up that value chain. If the battery question is the question of the early 21st century, making batteries capable of driving long distances, storage, an energy storage issue, China feels that if it pushes its way in that industry and creates a domestic market for green cars, all that technology is going to be developed in China, and all of those jobs further up the value chain that don't involve stuffing Disney toys are going to be based in China as well. It's only after those first things that I interpret China's push towards green cars. I think this is kind of important, and I'll give you something to flag or something to think about. There's a terrific reporter, one of my favorite in China, has just been relocated to Brazil. John Watts wrote a book called When a Billion Chinese Jump, largely about environmental issues in China. He wrote an article kind of laughing about China's efforts to develop electric cars, saying that there was only one Prius sold in 2012 or whatever year it was. My thought and response to that was, that's because the Chinese government hasn't decided Priuses is going to be what people drive. There's a way of rigging or shaping, we'll say, the market in order to guide consumers into doing the things that you want them to do. And what I'm suggesting with this last line, with those three explanations of why Chinese are going to be driving green cars and already are driving green bicycles, two-wheeled EVs or electric vehicles, is that it's overdetermined. There are all these reasons why they must push them out of internal combustion cars and into green cars. But how much will that solve? And will it solve environmental questions quickly enough? I'll get to that as one last bit on environmental. But I want to say one more mildly disturbing bit about China being forced into developing a car industry. I think of it as now China is doing onto other developing countries what was done onto it. If global organizations such as the WTO created a world in which China saw it as it's in its own best interest to push its citizenry into wanting cars, the Chinese are doing the same thing in other parts of the world too. They've only begun to export to America, but they're already exporting in huge numbers to Southeast Asia and Africa, helping build roads, creating that infrastructure both for an economy and a society depending on cars. So for those of us worried about whether these personal vehicles, cars as presently construed, are something that we can live with in this day and age, I hope I've given you something else to worry about. So lastly, the environmental implications of all this. I don't consider this to be a green fix. If you've just taken away half of a mountainside, merely painting it green. I mean, the air pollution stuff, the Atlantic Monthly, American journal, had an article about environmental pollution in China, and they quoted quite a bit by Dee Dee Tadlow, a New York Times columnist, about sort of index that she has for what activities she'll allow her children to do, and how many days a year her children are allowed to go outside without wearing a gas mask. And I basically, after reading that article, decided I'm not sure I can go to China December through February anymore, because the pollution in that time in particular, because of all that coal heating, all those homes, is just so off the chart. So, you know, I put some of the worst statistics about China's water tables dropping, acid rain, polluted cities, how many hundreds of thousands of people are dying early from all of that. You can just take my word for it. That's a pretty grim story. So what does all this mean? I say what happens not if China catches up with our standard of living and eats as much beef per capita, but what happens just as it inches slowly in this direction. It's already creating these huge and horrible reverberations. We read recently, I think the New York Times had an article a couple of weeks ago about pollution being transferred from the East Coast to the West Coast by way of China. The outsourcing of all those manufacturing jobs to China means instead of that stuff blowing into Europe, it's now blowing back across the Pacific onto California, so much so that what percentage? One-third of California's air pollution is generated by plants that are largely producing stuff for foreign markets like ours. Yeah, so this is my way of saying we need to worry what China's doing now, and even as it moves slowly in the direction of having our lifestyles. But how can we begrudge the Chinese from wanting the same type of lifestyles? As we said, the global consensus, our political leaders and the business executives that they work for, are essentially believe the same thing, that Chinese need to be driving these cars, need to be buying those Barbies for the world to experience the next round of economic growth. And that's much more important than anything else. So that in summary is my conclusion. Here I am, also taken by my friend over there, having my hair cut. And I say, yes, it's come a long way from the bowl. And again, I want to say the obvious, that it's amazing this sort of could be the same country that I visited when I was a college student, that instead of having these awful cement floors and this guy who nearly cuts off my ear, you have all that variety of consumer experience. But at what cost? Thank you. I'll stop there, and you can ask me any questions or make challenges.